So I'm going to start at a predictable place. I hope the rest of our conversation is entirely unpredictable, but this part is predictable. Mike, you haven't had a ton to say yet about Bitcoin, so that's where we're going to begin. And of course, Mike Corbat is going to end the controversy once and for all. We all know the contours of the debate. Is Bitcoin a currency? Is it a store of value like gold? Is it a game changer? Is it the end of finance as we know it? Is it a bubble? Is it a fraud? What is it?
It is likely to be technology and evolution. So we can look at the positives, we can look at the negatives, and we actually have had some things to say about it. So when you look at it, what we've had most to say about it is the underlying technology.
Yes. Oh, we're going to get there, the blockchain.
So like many first iterations of significant technology advances, it's not the end product.
What would you liken it to? Would you say that we are internet circa 1992 or somewhere else?
Very early. And again, when you think about where things are likely to go, we look out beyond the year ahead, the decade ahead, it's likely that we're going to see governments introduce cryptocurrency is a bad moniker for that, but a digital currency. And when we think about currencies and we think about value and we think about the importance of a currency to an economy, to a society, I don't think governments are going to take lightly other people coming in and potentially disrupting their abilities around data, around tax collection, around money laundering, around know your customer, and all those pieces that are there. But you won't hear us be dismissive in terms of the nascent technology because it's real and there's something there.
So for governments, and I presume for the banking industry, financial services perhaps even more broadly speaking, it's a case, it sounds to me like from your perspective, it's a case of if you can't beat them, join them.
Well, so in there, you touched on underlying, and that's what's interesting to us. We'll leave the debate of Bitcoin to the side, but really the distributed ledger technology. And if you've looked, I believe, are the first firm to truly commercialize that technology in a partnership with NASDAQ mm-hmm. and with Chain. Where we're actually today live through a vehicle called Citi Connect, actually clearing and settling non-public securities for NASDAQ. So commercial application, great technology, and I think we all know part of the challenge around some of this technology, and I think distributed ledger is one of those things where there's so many applications of it, we've got to be focused on the high use cases.
So you have one already, but for it to fulfill its promise, this distributed ledger technology, the verification, the trust mm-hmm. built into the code, if you will, one thing is required that Wall Street has historically been really bad at, and that's standardization. How long is it going to take for the industry to standardize around a private blockchain, and which one is it going to be? Because there are, as you know, a number of competing protocols.
Yeah, I don't think we necessarily need to standardize around an industry, but I think we've got to come to common standards in terms of what we develop. So we've already developed our own technology within Citi. We have something within there that we've experimented with called Citi Coin. And our own ability as the world's largest mover of money in the world every day to actually reduce frictions mm-hmm. for our customers, to use distributed ledger technology in terms of how they manage, move money, manage foreign exchange exposures, et cetera, across the firm. And as we move forward, and that's why I say that, you know, maybe that moment comes when a government actually introduces its own digital currencies and forces the industry to common standards to match accessibility in and out of that currency. But standardization within the industry is happening.
In the meantime, you can run it, if you will, internally.
We can.
The Citi Coin.
We can.
Now, the reason I ask about standardization is that if you're going to go where blockchain seems to be taking finance, which is to a point where it gets rid of the high behind the scenes, if you will, backroom cost associated with clearing and settlement and the capital that you have to put up, JP Morgan and Bank of America and Wells Fargo and Goldman Sachs and Morgan Stanley and Deutsche Bank and Credit Suisse, et cetera, are all going to have to be nodes on that network? Is it going to be the Citi network? And if not, whose network is it going to be?
We move money. We move about $4 trillion a day around the world. And a lot of that is in some digital or non-physical form. We're actually not moving piles of money.
Right.
So today, those networks exist. And actually yesterday, a number of us were at the clearinghouse where we're getting mm-hmm. ready to launch real-time payments. Long overdue, but we're all going to connect into that. We all have to use the same protocols, procedures, et cetera, to be part of that. And I would just view this as it evolves, as a natural evolution or occurrence as part of that.
Anecdotally, Mike, we here at Bloomberg see a real hunger for information about cryptocurrencies and for information about blockchain technology. Is there yet a similarly real demand, if you will, for access to blockchain technology from clients, or even access to crypto as an investable asset from clients?
I'd say it's been fairly limited and concentrated in terms of interest. I don't know if you've tried to go, but I would encourage people to go download it and try and use it. Today, it's still pretty clunky. You know, when you want to go to the corner store and get a loaf of bread or whatever you want to go
on. By the way, Mike Corbat just told you to go out and buy a Bitcoin for $7,000.
And try and use it and try the experience. And I think you'd find it today, you know, my word, you'd probably find it a bit clunky. But again, we can't be dismissive on the underlying technology and ultimately what it represents in terms of the next things that are coming down the pike.
I love this idea that you introduced at the very beginning that governments, or a government perhaps, like the U.S. government through the Treasury Department, might undertake to develop a cryptocurrency of its own. In the meantime, why is it that you think we haven't seen regulators, whether they be here, whether they be in the U.K., whether they be in Europe, do what the Chinese have done, which is kind of put a stop to something that does make it almost impossible to comply with know your client mm-hmm. and anti-money laundering?
You know, in some ways, there's the challenge that regulation actually stalls or impedes innovation. And so I think the regulators, again, it's a better question for them than for me, but as mm-hmm. an observer, I would guess or likely say that they're intrigued by the innovation. They're intrigued by the underlying technology. I think there is a future to digital currencies. And rather than cut it off at this point, let it run a bit. But I do believe at the point that it truly does become meaningful and difficult to manage around tax collection, around criminal activity, around tax evasion, money laundering, et cetera, that governments will have something meaningful to say on that.
And to close out the part about Bitcoin specifically, or cryptocurrencies, if you prefer, I'm going to get metaphysical on you for a moment. The magic of the financial system is the ability for banks to create money by extending credit in the fractional reserve system. And that all comes down to the belief among all of us that the every incremental dollar that you create in credit is as good as the fractional dollar that's backing it up. Mm-hmm. Bitcoin creates money out of thin air as well. It just does it in a different way, but it's still predicated on the belief system. If in fact governments take the kind of step that you anticipate they will, what's the financial system going to look like if it's no longer based, if it's based on the creation of digital money through technologies like the one developed by Satoshi Nakamoto, or if I think I got his name right, or is it going to be something akin to what exists now?
Well, if you go back and take what you said, I think you missed an important underlying...
I'm sure I did.
a premise, and that is deposit insurance. While you say we're creating something out of thin air, every deposit we take into the institution from a retail customer up to a specified amount is insured and guaranteed by the United States government, which then says that we're going to take those monies and we go relend them. And we have capital and we have liquidity and we have risk metrics and we have all those pieces that are there that are relatively transparent, that investors, in terms of people who buy our equity, buy our bond, people who provide financing to the company, can all see. and there's a transparency to that. So it's not that we're creating something out of thin air. There's real structure, process, guarantees to actually what the end product is. I think in Bitcoin, that's a bit more difficult, and it's part of the challenge in terms of really, what is it? As you started the conversation, and the honest answer is, I don't know. Is it a speculative vehicle? What is it? Is it a currency? And I think it's yet to be defined.
The beauty of the blockchain and other technologies for a company like yours is the opportunity they present, as we've discussed, to cut costs. And any of you who's a Citigroup shareholder, I'm sure, would agree that Mike has done a masterful job on expense control since he became CEO in 2012. If I'm not mistaken, Mike, the efficiency ratio most recently reported was 56%. That's cost as a percentage, operating costs as a percentage of revenue. And you inherited something with a 7 handle on it, which is to say about 71%. Where else beyond the blockchain do you see the greatest opportunities for Citi to use technology to cut costs?
Well, if you think about where we are today, I would describe us in a technology revolution with an embedded evolution occurring. And what's very different and in some ways most exciting about this revolution is the revolution is largely being driven by a benefit of customer experience. Mm-hmm. Unlike where we went from, you know, from physical labor to machinery, from steam and the evolution, this whole evolution has been driven by reducing frictions, making people's lives easier. The beauty, from my position, of that technology is that in many cases it's also cheaper to provide. The whole movement from physical analog to digital. But make no mistake, it's being driven and pulled by the customer experience.
So, given that you can improve customer experience while reducing cost, if you focus on the last part of that, is a 50% efficiency ratio something you see attainable?
We've talked about it, and how we think we get that. And I appreciate the compliment in terms of cost cutting, but I've also got to compliment my company and the team because it hasn't been all costs. In there, your efficiency ratio is a combination of revenues and costs, and we've done nicely in terms of growing revenues at the same time in terms of cutting and maintaining cost discipline. So there's been a balance to it. This technology plays a role in terms of what the future looks like. And as an example today, when you think about technology that's there and the way we interact, and there's so many examples, we can talk about our call centers. And so, you know, in the old days, you would call up and you'd want to know your balance or you lost your card. Today, you can go on your smart device and you can get all of those. You can get it at your fingertips. And as we know, physical versus digital interaction, much cheaper to provide, and you're much happier with the experience as opposed to waiting, having to go through authentication. And so as you think about what that looks and feels like in terms of your ability, and when I talk about the underlying evolution, so we've seen the revolution of the app and all those pieces, but there's the evolution of actually how we're delivering that. And I'll give you an interesting case study. So we recently did work around what you would consider as very natural in terms of pick your device, Siri, Alexa, walk into your kitchen or whatever it is and say, what's my balance? What, you know, when's my payment due or all those things? Sounds logical, sounds like pretty good. It sounds like the industry should be delivering. Along the way, what we discovered is that people in an open source don't like to speak out loud about their finances, and they appreciate even less the response coming back, right? And so actually what we did is we worked with Facebook, and we've launched this in Singapore around the Citi bot, where through your social network, you can actually go in and ask those questions and not have to go to the Citi app and get all that information coming back. So while this revolution is going on, there's the evolution of how we're delivering that technology in a way that's easier and better and more consistent for you to use.
Perhaps inadvertently, you raise an important question, and I know it's one that came up yesterday at the clearinghouse. How do you stop, call it an Amazon, or a Facebook, or a Google, which collectively have as much quality data on we consumers as you do, as a bank CEO, from if you will, invading your space, choosing to go into financial services, taking the data that they have, the fact that they haven't inherited a large legacy infrastructure and cost base, and do what you're doing equally well or better at a lower price?
The goal is not to stop them. I mean, Amazon has been great, all the things they've done. But what we can't do is sit idly by and allow them to take our business, right? The first rule of order.
Do you see them as a real threat?
Of course they are. Of course they are. I think they're a threat to any industry. And so, again, we can't be dismissive about any of it. But again, if we can provide those services in a way that makes you happy, you're not going to be out looking to replace it. And there, and when you think about banking relationships, we can go back and look at the statistics. They tend to be pretty sticky long-term relationships. So that's why we're investing so heavily in terms of technology and making sure, number one, we don't give you the excuse to go try something different or leave. And second, if you're not a customer or client of ours, we want to have you pay attention to what we're doing and, in fact, give you the excuse to come look at and try out what we're doing.
You mentioned earlier financial revolution. And you were articulate about it, but in some respects, we're already in the midst of a number of different financial revolutions. I'm thinking of one that you mentioned, the shift to mobile platforms. There's marketplace lending, there's ETFs and other passive instruments that have had revolutionary impact. It's already happening. Let's do a little blue sky thinking. What does the industry look like 5 years from now on the retail side, on the commercial side, on the institutional side? What's different?
So let's start with retail, because that's the one that probably gets talked about most. One is that we will continue the evolution from physical analog to digital. How does that manifest itself? Less branches? Are branches going away in the next 5 years? No. Smaller branches and branches that have different types of services. So if we go back, and the example I'll use here, let's go back to 1978 when Citi commercialized the ATM. In 1978, 79, people said, this is the death of branch banking. The ATM exists. Fast forward almost 40 years, and we've just started to see the curve bend in terms of the number of branches in the US, 40 years later. And so, but when you walk into a branch today, it's very different. Come into one of our branches, and what you'll see is you'll come into a vestibule. There's somewhere between 2 and 8 or 10 ATMs that are there. You come into the next part, there's people there to greet you, and you got to get to the back of the branch to actually find somebody to go queue up with and to do a teller transaction.
So give us a metric. 5 years from now, Citi has more or less 700 retail branches.
In the U.S.
In the U.S. and about 2,500 worldwide. So let's just talk about the U.S. How many do you figure you'll have 5 years from now? And how will the square footage of those branches differ from what you've got today?
So that number, to put it in context, that 700 is down about 300 over the last handful
of years. 5 years or so, yes.
The configuration of those branches has changed. And what you've seen is we've kind of gone from a branch on every street corner to one of what we call hubbing and spoking, so the big branch in a high traffic area where you can go in and do your full range of services from depositing, borrowing, savings, protecting, investing, all of those, to the more satellite branch where you've got a couple ATMs and you've got a few people in it and you can do most of the things, but you're not going to get the same kind of advice or financial interaction. So I won't say today what the absolute number is, but there will be less, and we will continue to push in terms of the technology and, as a result, what the square footage and what the presence of those branches looks and feels like.
The reason Citigroup has that large international branch network is that it remains the world's most global bank. At the same time, of course, Mike, the trend politically here in the United States and in some other places has been away from globalization and free trade, which, if it happens, given the way your bank is set up, probably can't be good for your company. Do you perceive that as a real threat?
Something we need to pay attention to. But if we go back and think of globalization, and we won't get into the history here of Bretton Woods and really what's happened, but without a doubt, globalization has lifted the standard of living in many places of the world. It's taken millions and millions and millions of people out of poverty. And I think it's a very tough thing to put back in the bottle. And why do I say that? Because when we talk about trade, and we talk about some countries have an advantage in agriculture, some countries have an advantage in terms of natural resources, some countries have an advantage in terms of labor. you're not going to take a country that is a mining country and instantly turn it into an agriculture country. No. And so what we see is less threat against globalization. But I think what we're conflating is a threat of globalization versus what I would describe as protectionism. Mm-hmm. And when you think of the world today and why protectionism is the hot topic, it's because we're in a world of slower growth. We're in the ninth year of recovery, and we've got a U.S. growing in the low twos. We've got a global economy maybe somewhere around three, and growth is tough to get. And so there's this natural tendency. And as I've traveled the world, my conversations with heads of state and finance ministers and heads of central bank is one that's gone from being a lot about growth to being a lot more about jobs because of the challenges of politics today. And the politicians know they need an engaged and employed workforce. And so we've seen this protectionism emerge, but what we know, and as you know, we've got a big business in Mexico that when we look at NAFTA and we break down NAFTA and the challenges between the U.S. and Mexico in terms of a trade deficit, it's largely automobiles. The rest of it is remarkably balanced. And what we see in automobiles is that it's actually largely the components of electronics that's changed since 1994. We've got to solve for that. And by the way, if those manufacturing jobs come back to the U.S., they probably largely come back a couple people, a dog and a bunch of robots that are going to assemble those cars. And so it's not necessarily that big or seismic change that comes from that form of protectionism.
Before we run, Mike, one last question for you. And it does relate to your point about political challenges and also the differences in wealth between countries, agriculture versus manufacturing ability, industry, if you will. In this case, natural resources. One market city has been in, left, and recently come back to is Saudi Arabia. And as you probably know, recent events in the kingdom, including the arrest of Prince Alwaleed bin Talal on the weekend, who happens to be one of Citigroup's largest shareholders and chief advocates, have cast some doubt on your company's plans. What can you tell us about Saudi Arabia? Well,
I should be turning it back with you being in the news business, but I would say it's been tough to really discern because while we have some headlines, we don't have much below that. We've got a number of people being held under this broad title of corruption, and we actually don't know what the specified charges or accusations are below that. From Prince Alwaleed's perspective, longtime shareholder, and while you describe him as one of our largest shareholders, he, as an individual, is amongst the largest individuals, but from an institutional perspective,
yes,
is significantly smaller.
And certainly smaller than what he used to
and
be.
Most, but what I would say in our interaction, and we've known Prince Alwaleed for 25 years, is he's been a very consistent, loyal supporter of our company. He's been with us in good times and bad times, and hopefully back to good times. And obviously we're watching. In terms of what we see going back into Saudi, I think you've got to be encouraged by what's been laid out in terms of the Vision 2030. Some of the
economic transformation.
I think it's a societal transformation.
That's true.
When we look at what's going on. So we went back into Saudi Arabia, and when we went back, we said, we're glad, we're proud to be back, but just so you know, the person running our franchise for the region for Saudi Arabia is a woman. They welcomed it. And so we look at some of the progressive things that are happening there. We're encouraged by it.